بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. In the last class of the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or rather the tafsir of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we looked at the 15th set of surah or verses to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in this class of tafsir, the way we go through the surah in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is we go through it according to the order of revelation. So therefore, the first surah we started with was Surah Al-Alaq, the first thing to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then we relate those surah or those ayat to the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why it's a lesson of tafsir through the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So far we've reached the 15th set of verses. And we mentioned last week that the way we're going to be going through those ayat and those surah, we're going to mention in order of revelation. But we're not going to do the tafsir of each and every single one. We're only going to do the tafsir of what we know, the sababu nuzul, the cause of revelation. Because not every single thing that's revealed in the Quran has a cause of revelation. Where some has a cause of revelation, and there's a hadith regarding it, why that thing, why that ayah was revealed. So when you go into the ayat that have what? Sababu nuzul. So the ayah we went through, or the surah that had the sabab al-nuzul before last week, was Surah Al-Duha. And we said the sabab al-nuzul of Surah Al-Duha was what? During Aam al-Huzn, the year of sadness of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we went through Aam al-Huzn of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in that surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْتِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. Allah is going to give you something you're going to be pleased with. So after Surah Al-Duha, from the seerah, went through what? Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. Through the Isra wal-Mi'raj, the ascension of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the heavens. And we said, from the things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he was pleased with in Isra wa Mi'raj was revealed in the 15th set of verses. So Surah Al-Duha was what? 11th or 12th, no, 11th. And after it, Surah Al-Sharhu. After it, Surah Al-Asr. After Surah Al-Asr, the 14th was what? Wal-Adiyati Dabha. And the 15th was what? Al-Kauthar. And this had a sabab al-nuzul and many ahadith that related concerning Al-Kauthar. So last week we said Al-Kauthar from the Isra wal-Mi'raj is from the things that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw in Isra wal-Mi'raj. That when he went to the seven heavens, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw An-Nahar, a river that he said, this river, it had domes of pearls, empty pearls on its bank. And this river, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this is the Kawthar, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised you. And we described in details many ahadith concerning Kawthar, that the soil of Kawthar is made from what? Misk. That Kawthar, the water of Kawthar flows over what? Pearls and diamond. That this Kawthar, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the amount of drinking vessels around it, كَعَدَدِ النُّجُومُ فِي السَّمَاءِ, is like the amount of stars in the skies. Because the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This Kawthar, the sweetness of the Kawthar, أَحْلَى مِنَ الْعَسَلِ, is sweeter than honey, وَأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْلَبَنِ, and it's whiter than milk. And there's many ahadith, beautiful ahadith we mentioned concerning this Kawthar, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore the mawdu', the topic of this surah is Al-Kawthar. So what we're going to do today, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, is to go through the verses of Al-Kawthar. So the mawdu' of the surah, anytime we look at a surah, look at the topic of the surah. The mawdu' of the surah, therefore, is what? Ya Luqman. The mawdu', the topic of this surah, Surah Al-Kauthar. The topic of the surah, as we mentioned last week, as they were saying in Kenya, Som Kali, the fasting is hard. The topic of the surah is Imtinanullahi ala Rasulihi, to show the favors and the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The many, many, many abundant blessing. And why do I say the abundant blessing based on last week's class? Why do I say the abundant blessing of Allah upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Why do we use the word abundant here? Barakallahu fi. Because kathirun in Arabic means much. But al-kawthar is an exaggerated version or exaggerated form of much, meaning abundant. So al-kawthar, it means that which is abundant. So Allah Ta'ala called it al-kawthar. So the mawdu', the topic of this surah, is the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abundant upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The other mawdu' of the surah is what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's defense and consoling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said, Inna shani'aka huwa abtar. That whoever is an enemy of yours, huwa al-abtar. Because the Quraysh, they used to say the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was what? Abtar. And abtar means al-maqtu' min al-khayr, somebody who's cut off from all goodness. Because the beliefs of those Arabs, the mushrikeen, was if you have a child, a male child that never reached manhood, you're devoid of all good. And the sons of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Qasim and Abdullah, they passed away before reaching maturity. So the Quraysh used to say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and say he is abtar, especially Abu Jahl and As ibn Wahil al-Sahmi. They used to call the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam al-abtar. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the ayah, Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. So this is the mawdu' of the surah. And this claim of the Quraysh, or this attack of the Quraysh against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is only a chain from the chains of the media and the public campaign against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to stain the reputation and the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam منذ بدء الوحي, from the beginning of revelation. They attempted to place doubt upon the revelation to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we're going to go all the way back, because I said from the beginning of revelation, right? And the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam began what surah? The message. Mudathir. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, became a prophet of what? Iqra. And he became a rasul wal mudathir. So the message started what? Al-Mudathir. So as soon as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came out and he called him Al-Mudathir, the campaign of the Quraysh, it began. The first thing they tried to do was to accuse the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of being a what? A liar. But when we looked at the seerah, this couldn't stick. Why couldn't it stick? Because the Quraysh themselves, they gave the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the title of what? As-Sadiqul Amin, the truthful, trustworthy one. So in Surah Al-Mudathir, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions their first campaign against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what was the first campaign, media and public campaign, to distort and stain the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? They went to one of the most influential, intellectual, gifted, wealthy, that had a lot of children from amongst them, to go and speak to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then, after speaking to him, to make a claim against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And who was this? Walid ibn Mughira, the one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, Surah Al-Mudathir. And where does Allah, Ya Mu'ad, Mus'ab, mention Walid ibn Mughira in Surah Al-Mudathir? Dharni wa man khalaqtu wahida. Leave me alone with one I, Allah Azza wa Jal, I created alone. So Walid ibn Mughira, when he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, I've seen many a mad people. This person is not mad. He said, I've heard the words and poetry, that which Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has come with is not poetry. So what did he do? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, innahu fakkara wa qaddar. He thought, he pondered, and he did what? He evaluated. Faqutila kayfa May he be destroyed. كَيْفَ قَدَّرْ. How he evaluated the situation. ثُمَّ نَظَرْ. Then he paused and he thought. ثُمَّ عَبَسَ وَبَصَرْ. And then he frowned and he scowled. And what did he come out with? إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا سِحْرٌ يُؤْثَرْ. That this is magic. So the first claim of the Quraysh was what? That which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with is what? Is magic. The second thing in the chain of events or media campaign against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when this could not stick, the next surah we went through that was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after Mudathir is a surah in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by the greatest of his creation to show the great character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what surah was that? Surah Al-Qalam. Allah Ta'ala said, Noon wal qalami wa ma yasturun. Allah Ta'ala swears by the pen. To refute their claim that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is what? Majnoon. Ma anta bi ni'mati rabbika bi majnoon. You, by the grace of your Lord, you're not majnoon. After this failed again, Abu Lahab and his wife sought to insult the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam directly. Directly. So Allah Ta'ala revealed, Tabbat yada Abi Lahabin Watab. After that, they went back to saying the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is what? Majnoon. Jayid, in Surah 2 At-Takwir, which went through after this, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Innahu laqawl rasulin kareem, dhi quwwatin 'inda dhil 'arshi makin. That this word, this Quran, is the word of a statement of a noble messenger, a powerful messenger who's stationed at the arsh, at the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who is this messenger that Allah ta'ala is speaking about here, Mus'ab? Ya Mus'ab, who is this messenger? Ya Salman. Allah ta'ala said, it's the word, or this is the statement, Rasulun Kareem, a powerful messenger who's stationed at the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muta'in thumma ameen. That this messenger is obeyed completely and is trustworthy. Jibreel alayhi salam. This the word of, or that was given to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by Jibreel. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا صَاحِبُكُمْ بِمَجْنُونَ. Fifthly, the Quraysh, after this, the wife Abu Lahab, she used to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam around. And then she realized the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was no longer receiving what? Wahi. So she made a claim that your Lord has what? Abandoned you. So Allah ta'ala revealed what? Surah 2? Al-Duha. Jayid? مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. After this now, what's the next thing they did from their campaign? The sixth thing to say the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is abtar, devoid of khayr. So the mawdu' of the surah is defense of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to console the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that although you may not have any child, male child that reach manhood, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you what? Al-Kauthar, abundant good. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins the surah with Inna a'tayna kal-kawthar. That verily we have given you al-kawthar. Who gave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam al-kawthar? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But here Allah ta'ala said Inna, verily we. In Arabic, because some of the mustashriqoon, some of the orientalists, they try to use this against the Muslims. That in the same way that they, or the mushrikeen, the polytheists, they believe in more than one God. You as Muslims also believe in more than one God. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we gave him. We gave him. But in the Arabic language, the pronouns, personal and accusative, are singular and plural. In English, we have the same thing. Personal pronoun is only one. Me, me. Or we. But in Arabic, you could use a personal pronoun for more than one person, for one person. So the Arabs, for example, if they're speaking to an elder, they'll not say, Kaifa haluka, how are you? They say, Kaifa, how are you, all of you, out of respect. And this is not only specific to Arabic, even in other languages, Nigerian languages. When you're speaking to an adult, you address them in the plural. And likewise, out of respect for a person for himself, he could use a plural personal pronoun for himself. Instead of saying I, it says what? We. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Inna a'tayna ka. And the ulama of tafsir, they said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses a personal pronoun, Damir Mutakallim Al-Azim, the greatest personal pronoun of the plural, due to what? The greatness of what is given the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which is what? Al-Kawthar. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna a'tainaka al-Kawthar. We've given you Al-Kawthar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could say, Inna a'tainaka kathir. But Allah ta'ala said Kawthar, because Kawthar means abundant. So for example, the word kathir has a verb. The noun much has a verb. What's the verb of kathir? Kathura. It's become much. So if you say kathura al-ghubar, there's too much dust. That's the verb. Now, if you want to say the dust is abundantly too much, what do Arabs say? Takawthara al-ghubar. Takawthara. So kawthar means abundant. Inna a'tainaka kal-kawthar. And when you say Rajulun, Abu Abdurrahman, Rajulun Kawthar, you could say he's Rajulun Kawthar. He's a man with Kawthar. It means he's extremely generous, extremely kind man. Wahuwa kadhalik. And he's such, mashallah ta'ala. Rajulun Kawthar. So if you say a man, Rajulun Kawthar is somebody who's very, 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 very generous. So the word Kawthar literally means what? We're giving you in abundance. So when Allah Ta'ala said to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Inna, it means verily, we've given you Al-Kawthar, abundantly. And based on this literal meaning of Al-Kawthar, some of the ulama, they say Al-Kawthar is what? Did you say last week? Nahrun fil Nahar. A Nahar, a river which the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was given. And there's two Nahar, like the brother asked last week. There's the one in Jannah and the one where the people be gathered Yawm Al-Qiyamah. Some of the ulama, based on this literal meaning of Al-Kawthar, they say, يدخل في عموم الكوثر, enters into Kawthar is the river in Jannah. The river when people are resurrected, يوم القيامة. Enter into Al-Kawthar is the prophethood of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because it is Kawthar, it's abundant goodness. Kawthar is the Risalatul Khatima. This message, the final message is Kawthar. Some of the ulama, they say Al-Kawthar is what? Al-Qur'an. So when Allah Ta'ala says, Inna a'tainaka al-Kawthar, it means we're giving you the Qur'an. Or you can mean we're giving you prophethood. Or you can mean we're giving you the river in Jannah, or the river people will drink from Yawm al-Qiyamah. So which one now do we take? What is the principle we mention in tafsir? That any verse in the book of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala that has more than one meaning, if there's no contradiction between those meanings, or none has a priority over the other, we take it all. So Al-Kawthar therefore is what? The Quran, Al-Islam, the river in Jannah. All of this is what? Al-Kawthar. And there's no contradiction between any of them. So it could be the prophethood of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It could be the Quran, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Kawthar, the non-literal meaning, could also say is what? The river which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been given in Jannah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَصَلِّي. So therefore pray لِرَبِّك. Out of what? Gratefulness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one of the greatest forms of thankfulness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, manifestation of it is what? As-salah. And what is as-salah? What is as-salah? Who could define as-salah? Linguistically, what is salah? Because say mushtashrikun, the orientalist, they try to use these verses to refute the Muslim. Inna. Likewise, the word salah. Salah linguistically means what? A dua. It means a dua, to invoke and to pray. A dua. And according to fiqh, salah is what? Af'al wa aqwal are actions as statements that are used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muftatahatum bit takbir. That begins with takbir and ends with what? Taslim. So therefore, the mustashriqun, the orientalists, they say, Kayf, Allah Ta'ala yusalli ala nabi. Allah prays to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But it doesn't mean this. Because the salatullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah's salah upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is what? Sheikh Sulaiman. Allah's salah upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is what? To mention him amongst the angels. And the salah of the angels is what? A dua for the person. So as-salah here, fasalli, means pray to your Lord. Either invoke your Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or perform the salah. And the reason salah that we pray, although it's not just dua, is called salah. Why is it called salah? Because part of the salah is what? Dua. Part of the salah is what? Dua. And that's why Surah Al-Fatiha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نِصْرَيْنِ. I divided the salah between me and my servant in two halves. And what do we find in Fatiha? What is it? Dua. اِهْدِينَ الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. That's why it's called a salah, prayer. Because a part, the great part of the salah is what itself? الدُّعَى. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَصَلِّي لِرَبِّكَ. And Allah ta'ala said, فَصَلِّي لَهُ. Did not say pray to him, but rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, instead of using a pronoun, pray to him, Allah ta'ala said, فَصَلِّي لِرَبِّكَ. Pray to your Lord. And why is it here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the word Lord? For those of us who have been attending the seer class, we said in the beginning of the seer, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first thing revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is what? Iqra' bismillah, la iqra' bismi rabbik. Why did Allah ta'ala reveal the first thing in the name of your Lord instead of the name of Allah azza wa jal? Exactly. The mushrikun, they believed in the what? The lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned rabbik, your Lord. Because a rabb, what does it mean? What is tawheed al-rububiyyah? Allah ta'ala is the creator. Allah ta'ala one that controls all affairs. So, فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ. Pray to your Lord who created, controls all affairs. If he's the one that created, controls all of it, and the one that gives and takes, he's the one that deserves what? Worship. And that's why I find many times the Quran, Allah ta'ala uses a rububiyyah to prove a what? Uluhiyyah. He uses his lordship to prove he's the only one that deserves what? Worship. So if you look at the first command in the Quran, in the order of the Quran, Allah uses his lordship to prove his what? Is ibadah, tawheed al-ibadah. What is the first command in the Quran? Ya ayyuhan nas, u'budu rabbakum. Worship your Lord. Allah ta'ala uses rububiyyah to prove what? Uluhiyyah. Why should you worship your Lord? U'budu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum. The one that created you. So here Allah ta'ala, فَصَلِّ لِي لَهُ لَا فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ. Pray to your what? To your Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَانْحَرْ. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala order Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ. Pray to your Lord, وَانْحَرْ. وَنَحَرْ, slaughtering here is a ذَبْحُ. وَذْبَحْ. In Arabic, to say slaughter is what? Dhabaha and wadbah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said wanhar. Because wanhar is a special type of slaughtering. This type of slaughtering is for what? Camels. Yes? When you slaughter any other animal, dhabahtu. When you slaughter a camel, nahartu. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in order to show his gratefulness to Allah azza wa jalla to sacrifice the most precious, the most valued of the wealth of the Arabs, which is what? The camel. So فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ specifically means sacrifice a what? A camel. But entering into this also is anything other than a camel. A sheep, a cow, وَانْحَرْ. Out of gratefulness to who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is part of the tawheed of Allah azza wa jal. The al-dhabh, slaughtering is only for who? For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ulama, they mention that rather than wadbah, there's another reason which you mention in the tafsir of other surah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions something, even though something else could have been used. For example, Allah ta'ala said, wanhar. So if we look at the ayat, inna a'toynaka kal kawthar, fasalli li rabbika wanhar, inna shani'aka huwal abtar. What do you notice in every single ayah? Raw, raw, raw. This is called as-saj'a, one of the miracles of the Quran, or the ways of the Quran. That things, they rhyme. We did this in a previous surah. They go, so, ar. Sorry? Yes. A'toynaka kalkaw thar. Fasalli li rabbika wan har. Inna shani'aka wal ab tar. So that's another reason to say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said wan har. Inna shani'aka huwal abtar. that the one that's an enemy to you is the one that is abtar, that is devoid of all goodness. So this is Surah Al-Kauthar. So the mawdu' of the surah, the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also defense and to console the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is not abtar. Because the one that's devoid of all good is the one that ends up in the hellfire, the one that's not guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why for us as believers, that so long as you're upon the deen of Allah, the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no matter whatever anyone has above you that opposes the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you are not abtar, he is abtar. Any person opposes you for the sunnah is abtar. Any kafir, no matter what he possesses from this dunya, he is abtar. And that's why I still mention many a time, one of the ulama of Egypt in those days, I forgot the name of the scholar. And those days, the scholars, mashallah ta'ala, the respect people had for them, the way they would glorify them and give them. It was on a very, you know, what do you call it again? Extravagant kind of a ride on a caravan. And it was on this caravan, beautiful horse. And a Christian from the Christians of Egypt, he saw him. And he said, how could your situation be like this? And your prophet has said, that a dunya sijnun mu'min wa jannatul kafirin. That this dunya is supposed to be a prisoner for the believers, and it's supposed to be a prisoner for the believers and the jannah for the kuffar. Look at my situation. And this Christian was a poor person, destitute. He said, look at my situation and look at your situation. This is your jannah now, and this is my jahannam. So the scholar turned to him and said, compared to what is waiting for me in the hereafter, no matter what I get in this dunya from joy, this is still a prison. And compared to the punishment that's waiting for you in the hereafter, no matter what suffering you get in this dunya, this is your jannah. So the one upon the book of Allah, the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is never abtar. And the one that opposes the book of Allah, the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is abtar. Inshallah ta'ala, we stop here. Next week, we'll go back to the seerah. This was a short class. We'll go back to the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and look at the next set of verses to be revealed. Now, I encourage the brothers, not just this class because it's my class, but generally speaking, try as much as possible to attend the classes in Ramadan, especially classes concerning the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. Because like we mentioned, month of Ramadan is month of Quran, but not just recitation, but contemplation upon the book of Allah Ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran to be recited. And he also revealed the Quran to be what? Contemplated upon. Kitabun anzalnahu, we send out this book for what? Liyadabbaru ayati, in order for to contemplate upon the verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for it to be a guidance for us. Try to attend these classes. In many masajid after Asr, people have these classes or these remembrances. Even if you understand a little from it, sit there and be patient with it, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Try to go through the tafsir of the Quran in Ramadan. So we're going to continue next week, inshallah, at a longer length. Also, the brother made a good point to me, Abu Amatillah, which is what we mentioned about finish the Quran at least 7 times in Ramadan. I said in the khutbah, 2.5 hours. This is the mathematician. Ibn Qais, Allahumma barak with their math. How many hours do we have to do if we want to finish 7 times? How many hours? How long do we have to do if we want to finish 7 times?
7 times?
Yes. Yes. 7 times. And if a juice takes about 30 minutes, that means 7 times. How many hours is that? Astaghfirullah ya Luqman. 3.5 hours. Jazakallah khair. I said 2.5 hours. Huh? Fasting. We're fasting, yes. 3.5 hours, inshallah ta'ala. Jazakallah khair, Abu Amatullah, for that. Subhanakallah, bihamdika, shahadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.